Even cute-looking blowfish, fugu, served as sashimi or in a hot pot. It makes a classic winter dish in Japan. Fugu is considered a gourmet treat. But its internal organs contain a potent poison called tetrodotoxin. Over the centuries, many people have died from this toxin. But that hasn't stopped many others from continuing to eat fugu. Techniques have been perfected to eliminate the poison from the portions that are eaten. And today, specially certified chefs serve a perfectly safe-to-eat fugu cuisine. Now, more affordable fugu is coming onto the market. And research on poison-free fugu has made strides, opening up new culinary possibilities for this delicacy of the sea. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at fugu blowfish, how it stimulates the culinary curiosity of the Japanese and exemplifies a never-ending quest for delicious options.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for today is the fish known in Japanese as fugu, which generally translates in English as blowfish. And I've come to the city of Shimonoseki, which is the biggest distribution center for fugu in the whole of Japan. And over here, this rather impressive looking building here is an aquarium, which has the biggest collection of fugu in the world. Let's go in and take a look because it's absolutely freezing out here and snowing into the bargain. Well, it's nice and warm in here anyway. And this is a part of the aquarium that's devoted entirely to different species of fugu. In this place here, these are all, I guess, slightly distant relations of the fugu. These all come from the southern part of Australia. And there are some amazing markings on some of these. And over here in this tank, there are some from the Okinawa area. These are actually edible. They eat them in Okinawa, but if you try to eat them and if you get them angry, take a look at how they're going to end up looking. And this is the main attraction, the gourmet delicacy known in Japanese as torafugu. These are pretty impressive beasts. The biggest one in this tank, which I think is that one over there in the back there, is about 8 kilograms. Fugu do have a fairly nasty poison, but Japanese people also love to eat them. Let's find out how they do that.
Fugu is a gourmet food in Japan. It's often enjoyed in a formal dining setting, on special occasions, or with important guests. Let's look at some ways of enjoying fugu. First, sashimi. Fugu sashimi is sliced extremely thinly, to the point of translucency. The flesh is elastic and firm, and slicing it like this gives just the right chewiness for its taste to be best appreciated. Preparing the sashimi display requires dexterity and concentration. It's common to lay down slices of sashimi more thickly towards the center of the plate. The edges of the slices are folded back to create a three-dimensional flower design. It's done. What kind of flower pattern is it? A chrysanthemum, with each slice of sashimi serving as a petal. This is a culinary work of art that appeals to the eye as well as to the palate. Fugu sashimi is dipped in a type of ponzu sauce, which includes soy sauce, citrus juice, and a stock made from dried bonito flakes and kombu seaweed. Delicious. The flavor bursts in your mouth. Fugu sashimi tastes even better with a kind of negi leek. The slight sweetness of the fish mingles harmoniously with the crispness of the negi. In fact, these negi are a variety specially cultivated for eating with fugu. They have a much less distinctive smell than ordinary negi, so that they won't overpower fugu's delicate flavour. Fugu hot pot offers a completely different eating experience. Moist, hearty chunks of fugu flesh mingle perfectly with the flavour of the vegetables. Fugu provides a deeply satisfying culinary experience. But while fugu is delicious, it's also lethal. The poison is called tetrodotoxin, which paralyzes nerves and can even kill you. Almost every year, several people die after eating fugu. The location of the poison varies by species. In Tora fugu, the liver and ovaries have the highest toxin concentration. The toxin is flavorless, odorless, and heat stable. A single fugu contains enough of this potent toxin to kill several people. After the organs are removed, official guidelines specify that they be disposed of in special locked containers to prevent mixing with other waste or being used for a criminal purpose. Preparation of fugu can only legally be performed by chefs who have obtained a special license issued by each prefecture after passing a test. In Yamaguchi Prefecture, Japan's fugu heartland, the test requires that a fugu be gutted and poisonous portions removed within 20 minutes. For chefs who have diners' lives in their hands, proper technique is vital. Only chefs who are licensed to handle fugu are employed by restaurants and fugu processing facilities. At this facility, fugu organs are removed, the flesh is carefully washed, and the edible parts are packaged for sale. This makes it possible to safely enjoy fugu at home. Certain organs of fugu are edible. The milt, or soft roe, of the Tora fugu species is not poisonous. Called shirako, it is delicious and in limited supply, making it a rare delicacy. Typically, it's eaten steamed or roasted. Here goes. Ooh, it melts in your mouth like cream. A typical fugu feast concludes with a rice porridge of fugu broth with egg. The rice absorbs plenty of the savory essence from the fugu flesh and bones. The Japanese extract every particle of flavor from the parts of fugu that can be eaten.
This little guy here is a mascot for the Karato Market in Shimonoseki, which is where we are now. It's a big wholesale market where you'll find both food industry professionals and ordinary consumers. Here's a shop that specializes in fugu. See, they've got sets of sashimi all laid out here. If you're gonna do it at home, you're not going to want to have to cut it up like this, so that's pretty convenient. You see what that is? It's the mouth of the blowfish. You put it in hot sake and you put a lid on it, let it stew for a little while, and it flavors the sake. People like to consume just about every part of this fish that they can. Fugu has a reputation for being fairly expensive, but here in the vicinity of the market you can actually find some pretty reasonably priced snacks. This shop here has stuff like fugu burgers, in fact. You're thinking, this really exotic fish, what's it going to taste like in a burger like this? You might be surprised. It actually tastes just like you would expect a fish burger to taste. There you go. I'm going to have some more of it, actually, because it does taste pretty good. While I'm doing that, let's take a look at the relationship between fugu and the Japanese over the centuries.
Fugu has been eaten in the Japanese archipelago for over 2,000 years. Shell mounds of the prehistoric Jomon culture are found in many parts of Japan. Fugu teeth have been found in these mounds. This indicates that even the people of ancient Japan ate fugu. A dictionary written in the 10th century includes the word fuku, which is what fugu was called back then. And it's thought that fuku came from another word, fukuramu, meaning swell up, because the fish does swell up when alarmed. The first restrictions on fugu consumption were instituted by Toyotomi Hideyoshi, Japan's supreme warlord. Towards the end of the 16th century, he was amassing troops from across Japan for an invasion of the Korean Peninsula. But before setting sail, a number of his recruits ate fugu and died from the poison. Furious, Hideyoshi issued a ban on eating fugu. For a long time after that, it was officially forbidden to eat fugu in Japan. But even if it was banned in public, people continue to eat it covertly. This 19th century woodblock print shows a wild boar trying to decide whether to buy fugu from a peddler. Fugu poison is as deadly to a human as a hunter's rifle is to a boar. This humorous image equates the deadly effect of fugu poison to a bullet. The famous poet named Yosabu Son wrote this haiku. Had fugu soup, I'm still alive, I woke up. The haiku expresses relief at having survived after eating fugu the day before. In that era, people did take their lives in their hands to taste the delights of fugu. But at the same time, techniques for removing the poison from fugu were advancing. Ishikawa Prefecture has a processing facility where the poisonous ovaries are turned into a perfectly harmless and edible food product. The ovaries of the locally caught goma fugu are pickled for a year in salt, and then two more years in the rice bran that's shaved off when you polish rice. During the pickling, an extract of fermented sardines is poured over the ovaries to mature them. This removes the poison from the ovaries and gives them a deep umami flavor. Exactly how this process eliminates the toxin remains a mystery. For that reason, only a handful of producers who continue to follow the traditional method are permitted to produce this food. In the late 19th century, even as Japan embraced the modern industrial world, fugu consumption remained prohibited. The prohibition was finally lifted due to an incident in Shimonoseki. In late 1887, a VIP paid a visit to a certain restaurant in Shimonoseki. The man was Hirobumi Ito, Japan's first prime minister. But the weather had been stormy, and the local fishermen had caught nothing. The restaurant's manager could only offer him one option, the forbidden fugu. The prime minister took a bite of fugu and was astounded by its delicious flavor. The next year, he ordered the fugu ban lifted in Yamaguchi Prefecture. Later, other prefectures gradually lifted the ban as well. Shimonoseki, where fugu eating first became legal again, remains famous as the capital of fugu in Japan. There are statues and pictures of the famous fish all over town. A long and close association between the Japanese and fugu has remained unbroken through the centuries. Thank you.
It's just past 3 o'clock in the morning and I'm in Haedomari, which is the world's only wholesale market that specializes in fugu. The fish are being brought in now and the bidding's going to start very shortly. When you all have your hands inside the bag, it's hard to tell how you're negotiating the price. So how do you do that?
I, the seller, have my hand like this and ask buyers how much they want to bid. They indicate their bidding price by holding my fingers. One finger, two fingers, three, four, five. That's how we do it.
How much were the fish selling for today?
The highest was about 22,000 yen per kilo. Fugu about this big weigh 2 kilograms or so, and they sold for between 40,000 and 50,000 yen each.
Why do you use the bag anyway?
Fugu auctions date back to the time when people still wore kimonos. And back then the bidding was done inside the sleeve of a kimono. And that eventually turned into this bag method auction. I believe Haedomari Market is the only place in the world where it's done like this.
In addition to the gourmet blowfish known as torafugu, there's another more affordable variety which has been making a presence on the market in recent years. Next, we're going to take a look at that.
The city of Hagi, about 60 kilometers from Shimonoseki. Every March, a fugu festival is held here. Many people come from around Yamaguchi Prefecture and beyond to try the free fugu sashimi and buy fugu products at bargain prices. Fugu sashimi lines this huge platter. There's enough here for 500 people to eat a couple of pieces each. But this is mafugu, not the gourmet torafugu. When people say fugu, they usually mean torafugu. Mafugu is still relatively unknown. This event is being held to broaden the public's awareness of mafugu. All these mafugu are wild. How do fishermen catch them? At 7 a.m., mafugu fisherman Hideo Nakamura sets out. He's a third-generation Hagi fisherman, and he's heading for fishing grounds 80 kilometers offshore. Nakamura catches mafugu using the long line fishing method. In many other places, dragnets are used, but in Hagi, the fugu are hooked individually to assure better quality live fish. Nakamura puts out 700 hooks at a time, all baited. Battling the sometimes rough swell of the Sea of Japan for 6 hours, he finally arrives at the fishing ground. The long line stretches for 3.5 kilometers and takes an hour to play out. Once it has been played out, it can't be reeled back in immediately. He must wait until the fugu bite. They don't bite right away, they have a nibble first, and if it's not tasty, they just say no thanks and swim away. After waiting 30 minutes, he starts reeling in the long line. The fish begin flopping over the rail. Fugu that have been suddenly yanked up to the surface from 100 meters down puff themselves up and will die if left that way. So Nakamura deftly punctures their swim bladders with a metal tube to let the air out. Then the fugu return to normal and can be brought live to market. Nakamura is hauling in one fugu after another. Because the mafugu is a schooling fish, once you catch one, you're sure to catch a string of them. Japan's 500 mafugu. For the fishermen of Hagi who have been catching fugu for generations, mafugu is a familiar treat. Whenever Hagi fishermen gather, mafugu will feature on the menu. Rather than a thin sashimi served in fancy restaurants, the fishermen enjoy it in thicker, raw chunks. Fugu certainly has a gourmet image, but mafugu is a delicious fish that anyone can enjoy. We all love it. Torofugu is not the only fugu species offering culinary delights. The popularity of Hagi caught mafugu is on the rise.
There are 22 different species of fugu that have been approved for human consumption in Japan. Gives you some idea of the popularity of blowfish in this country. Nowadays, anybody can eat perfectly safe fugu that's had all the toxic parts removed. But people are also doing research on how to breed naturally toxin-free fugu. Let's take a look.
The city of Karatsu is in Saga Prefecture. It's the base of operations for a man on a quest to develop poison-free fugu. Yoshihisa Ota runs a fugu aquaculture business. He raises poison-free fugu in indoor pens. Originally, around 10 years ago, Ota built aquatic pens on land in which he could carefully control temperature and water quality in order to raise high-quality fugu. The pens have sandy bottoms where the fugu can dig in and rest. Fugu are sensitive to environmental change, so this feature is essential to raising healthy fish. Ota focused in particular on the liver of his fugu. He thought the liver of a cultivated fugu would be free of poison. But the law banned the sale of fugu liver on the grounds that the liver was very poisonous. At the same time, this part of the fish was known to taste good. It's a big waste to be discarding this delicious part of the fish. It tastes so great that if we could market it to customers, it would become a regional delicacy and a stimulus to the local economy. Ota began his work on developing poison-free fugu after meeting researchers at Nagasaki University. One of them, Professor Osamu Arakawa, had been doing research on natural biotoxins for many years. People used to think that fugu produced their own toxin, but in fact, they store up the toxin that they ingest by eating starfish and turban shells. Fugu have sturdy teeth that enable them to feed on hard-shell seafloor creatures like shellfish, crabs, and starfish. Scientists discovered that these creatures contain Vibrio bacteria that produce tetrodotoxin. This is the substance that makes fugu poisonous. Starfish and shellfish eat the Vibrio bacteria and store up the toxin in their tissues. Then the fugu eat the starfish and shellfish. In this way, the toxin accumulates in fugu tissues. Ota made sure no Vibrio bacteria got into his aquatic pens by filtering and sterilizing, then recirculating ocean water. He feeds his fugu on mixed feed made from fish meal, which contains none of the Vibrio bacteria. But could these measures make the livers of the fugu an edible delicacy for diners? Ota came up with the idea of a fugu liver special zone. The special zone system makes certain regulations more flexible only in designated areas. The aim is to revitalize the local area in question. With the approval of the Japanese government, in this zone exclusively, people would be allowed to eat poison-free fugu liver. In 2005, a hot spring resort town in Saga Prefecture applied to the national government for the Fugu Liver Special Zone designation as a means of attracting tourists. but the application was declined on grounds of insufficient data on fugu toxicity. Nevertheless, Orta and Arakawa pushed ahead with the research, trying to gather more reliable data. We have examined around 4,000 fish over a period of 9 years, and no poison has been found in any of them. I believe we've demonstrated that we can raise toxin-free fugu. In 2010, this time the city of Karatsu applied for the special zone designation, backing its appeal with reams of scientific data. However, saying that the mechanism of toxicity remains poorly understood, the government again rejected the application. Still, Orta refused to give up his dream. Now he's trying to come up with a way for people to eat toxin-free fugu liver under existing laws and regulations. Having many visitors would stimulate the local economy. I'm hoping we'll create a new culinary movement. And so Orta's battle continues to bring Japan's gastronomes fugu liver that they can eat with confidence.
And we leave you with, would you believe, the world's biggest fugu statue? This one was made as an offering to a Shinto shrine here in Shimonoseki. Japan has a rich and varied culinary culture within which fugu does hold a special place. As we've established on today's program, you can eat it with complete safety these days. So if you're interested to find out more about the taste and the texture of the blowfish, by all means come to Japan and try it out, but at a licensed restaurant. And as they say, folks, don't try it at home. I'll see you again next time.
Next time, Haneda Airport. Haneda has been revamped so that it can resume duties as an airport serving cities around the world and around the clock. Even cute-looking blowfish, fugu. Served as sashimi or in a hot pot, it makes a classic winter dish in Japan. Fugu is considered a gourmet treat. But its internal organs contain a potent poison called tetrodotoxin. Over the centuries, many people have died from this toxin. But that hasn't stopped many others from continuing to eat fugu. Techniques have been perfected to eliminate the poison from the portions that are eaten. And today, specially certified chefs serve a perfectly safe-to-eat fugu cuisine. Now, more affordable fugu is coming onto the market. And research on poison-free fugu has made strides, opening up new culinary possibilities for this delicacy of the sea. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at fugu blowfish, how it stimulates the culinary curiosity of the Japanese and exemplifies a never-ending quest for delicious options.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for today is the fish known in Japanese as fugu, which generally translates in English as blowfish. And I've come to the city of Shimonoseki, which is the biggest distribution center for fugu in the whole of Japan. And over here, this rather impressive looking building here is an aquarium, which has the biggest collection of fugu in the world. Let's go in and take a look because it's absolutely freezing out here and snowing into the bargain. Well, it's nice and warm in here anyway. And this is a part of the aquarium that's devoted entirely to different species of fugu. In this place here, these are all, I guess, slightly distant relations of the fugu. These all come from the southern part of Australia. And there are some amazing markings on some of these. And over here in this tank, there are some from the Okinawa area. These are actually edible. They eat them in Okinawa. But if you try to eat them and if you get them angry, take a look at how they're going to end up looking. And this is the main attraction, the gourmet delicacy known in Japanese as torafugu. These are pretty impressive beasts. The biggest one in this tank, which I think is that one over there in the back there, is about 8 kilograms. Fugu do have a fairly nasty poison, but Japanese people also love to eat them. Let's find out how they do that.
Fugu is a gourmet food in Japan. It's often enjoyed in a formal dining setting, on special occasions, or with important guests. Let's look at some ways of enjoying fugu. First, sashimi. Fugu sashimi is sliced extremely thinly, to the point of translucency. The flesh is elastic and firm, and slicing it like this gives just the right chewiness for its taste to be best appreciated. Preparing the sashimi display requires dexterity and concentration. It's common to lay down slices of sashimi more thickly towards the center of the plate. The edges of the slices are folded back to create a three-dimensional flower design. It's done. What kind of flower pattern is it? A chrysanthemum, with each slice of sashimi serving as a petal. This is a culinary work of art that appeals to the eye as well as to the palate. Fugu sashimi is dipped in a type of ponzu sauce, which includes soy sauce, citrus juice, and a stock made from dried bonito flakes and kombu seaweed. Delicious. The flavor bursts in your mouth. Fugu sashimi tastes even better with a kind of negi leek. The slight sweetness of the fish mingles harmoniously with the crispness of the negi. In fact, these negi are a variety specially cultivated for eating with fugu. They have a much less distinctive smell than ordinary negi, so that they won't overpower fugu's delicate flavor. Fugu hot pot offers a completely different eating experience. Moist, hearty chunks of fugu flesh mingle perfectly with the flavor of the vegetables. Fugu provides a deeply satisfying culinary experience. But while fugu is delicious, it's also lethal. The poison is called tetrodotoxin, which paralyzes nerves and can even kill you. Almost every year, several people die after eating fugu. The location of the poison varies by species. In torafugu, the liver and ovaries have the highest toxin concentration. The toxin is flavorless, odorless, and heat stable. A single fugu contains enough of this potent toxin to kill several people. After the organs are removed, official guidelines specify that they be disposed of in special locked containers to prevent mixing with other waste or being used for a criminal purpose. Preparation of fugu can only legally be performed by chefs who have obtained a special license issued by each prefecture after passing a test. In Yamaguchi Prefecture, Japan's fugu heartland, the test requires that a fugu be gutted and poisonous portions removed within 20 minutes. For chefs who have diners' lives in their hands, proper technique is vital. Only chefs who are licensed to handle fugu are employed by restaurants and fugu processing facilities. At this facility, fugu organs are removed, the flesh is carefully washed, and the edible parts are packaged for sale. This makes it possible to safely enjoy fugu at home. Certain organs of fugu are edible. The milt, or soft roe, of the torofugu species is not poisonous. Called shirako, it is delicious and in limited supply, making it a rare delicacy. Typically, it's eaten steamed or roasted. Here goes. Ooh, it melts in your mouth like cream. A typical fugu feast concludes with a rice porridge of fugu broth with egg. The rice absorbs plenty of the savory essence from the fugu flesh and bones. The Japanese extract every particle of flavor from the parts of fugu that can be eaten.
This little guy here is a mascot for the Karato Market in Shimonoseki, which is where we are now. It's a big wholesale market where you'll find both food industry professionals and ordinary consumers. Here's a shop that specializes in fugu. You see, they've got sets of sashimi all laid out here. If you're going to do it at home, you're not going to want to have to cut it up like this, so that's pretty convenient. You see what that is? It's the mouth of the blowfish. You put it in hot sake and you put a lid on it, let it stew for a little while, and it flavors the sake. People like to consume just about every part of this fish that they can. Fugu has a reputation for being fairly expensive, but here in the vicinity of the market, you can actually find some pretty reasonably priced snacks. This shop here has stuff like fugu burgers, in fact. You're thinking, this really exotic fish, what's it going to taste like in a burger like this? You might be surprised. It actually tastes just like you would expect a fish burger to taste. There you go. I'm going to have some more of it, actually, because it does taste pretty good. While I'm doing that, let's take a look at the relationship between fugu and the Japanese over the centuries.
Fugu has been eaten in the Japanese archipelago for over 2,000 years. Shell mounds of the prehistoric Jomon culture are found in many parts of Japan. Fugu teeth have been found in these mounds. This indicates that even the people of ancient Japan ate fugu. A dictionary written in the 10th century includes the word fuku, which is what fugu was called back then. And it's thought that fuku came from another word, fukuramu, meaning swell up, because the fish does swell up when alarmed. The first restrictions on fugu consumption were instituted by Toyotomi Hideyoshi, Japan's supreme warlord. Towards the end of the 16th century, he was amassing troops from across Japan for an invasion of the Korean Peninsula. But before setting sail, a number of his recruits ate fugu and died from the poison. Furious, Hideyoshi issued a ban on eating fugu. For a long time after that, it was officially forbidden to eat fugu in Japan. But even if it was banned in public, people continued to eat it covertly. This 19th century woodblock print shows a wild boar trying to decide whether to buy fugu from a peddler. Fugu poison is as deadly to a human as a hunter's rifle is to a boar. This humorous image equates the deadly effect of fugu poison to a bullet. The famous poet named Yosabuson wrote this haiku: had fugu soup, I'm still alive. I woke up. The haiku expresses relief at having survived after eating fugu the day before. In that era, people did take their lives in their hands to taste the delights of fugu. But at the same time, techniques for removing the poison from fugu were advancing. Ishikawa Prefecture has a processing facility where the poisonous ovaries are turned into a perfectly harmless and edible food product. The ovaries of the locally caught goma fugu are pickled for a year in salt, and then two more years in the rice bran that's shaved off when you polish rice. During the pickling, an extract of fermented sardines is poured over the ovaries to mature them. This removes the poison from the ovaries and gives them a deep umami flavor. Exactly how this process eliminates the toxin remains a mystery. For that reason, only a handful of producers who continue to follow the traditional method are permitted to produce this food. In the late 19th century, even as Japan embraced the modern industrial world, fugu consumption remained prohibited. The prohibition was finally lifted due to an incident in Shimonoseki. In late 1887, a VIP paid a visit to a certain restaurant in Shimonoseki. The man was Hirobumi Ito, Japan's first prime minister. But the weather had been stormy, and the local fishermen had caught nothing. The restaurant's manager could only offer him one option, the forbidden fugu. The prime minister took a bite of fugu and was astounded by its delicious flavor. The next year, he ordered the fugu ban lifted in Yamaguchi Prefecture. Later, other prefectures gradually lifted the ban as well. Shimonoseki, where fugu eating first became legal again, remains famous as the capital of fugu in Japan. There are statues and pictures of the famous fish all over town. A long and close association between the Japanese and fugu has remained unbroken through the centuries.
It's just past 3 o'clock in the morning and I'm in Haedomari, which is the world's only wholesale market that specializes in fugu. The fish are being brought in now and the bidding's going to start very shortly. When you all have your hands inside the bag, it's hard to tell how you're negotiating the price. So how do you do that?
I, the seller, have my hand like this and ask buyers how much they want to bid. They indicate their bidding price by holding my fingers. One finger, two fingers, three, four, five. That's how we do it.
How much were the fish selling for today?
The highest was about 22,000 yen per kilo. Fugu about this big weigh 2 kilograms or so, and they sold for between 40,000 and 50,000 yen each.
Why do you use the bag anyway?
Fugu auctions date back to the time when people still wore kimonos. And back then the bidding was done inside the sleeve of a kimono. And that eventually turned into this bag method auction. I believe Haedomari Market is the only place in the world where it's done like this.
In addition to the gourmet blowfish known as torafugu, there's another more affordable variety which has been making a presence on the market in recent years. Next, we're going to take a look at that.
The city of Hagi, about 60 kilometers from Shimonoseki. Every March, a Fugu festival is held here. Many people come from around Yamaguchi Prefecture and beyond to try the free Fugu sashimi and buy Fugu products at bargain prices. Fugu sashimi lines this huge platter. There's enough here for 500 people to eat a couple of pieces each. But this is mafugu, not the gourmet torafugu. When people say fugu, they usually mean torafugu. Mafugu is still relatively unknown. This event is being held to broaden the public's awareness of mafugu. All these mafugu are wild. How do fishermen catch them? At 7 a.m, mafugu fisherman Hideo Nakamura sets out. He's a third-generation Hagi fisherman, and he's heading for fishing grounds 80 kilometers offshore. Nakamura catches mafugu using the long-line fishing method. In many other places, dragnets are used. But in Hagi, the fugu are hooked individually to assure better quality live fish. Nakamura puts out 700 hooks at a time, all baited. Battling the sometimes rough swell of the Sea of Japan for 6 hours, he finally arrives at the fishing ground. The long line stretches for 3.5 kilometers and takes an hour to play out. Once it has been played out, it can't be reeled back in immediately. He must wait until the fugu bite. They don't bite right away. They have a nibble first, and if it's not tasty, they just say no thanks and swim away. After waiting 30 minutes, he starts reeling in the long line. The fish begin flopping over the rail. Fugu that have been so